While the conservatives looks upon a democratic movement from below, this and the exercise of agency is what he sees, a terrible disturbance in the private life of power. Corey Robin, Reactionary Mind, Conservatism from Edmund Burke to Sarah Palin. Welcome back, everybody.
Yes. Welcome back to part two of the history of reaction in D&D. Rob, last episode, we took our listeners on a whirlwind tour from the satanic panic and moral crusades of the 1980s through the early aughts to the emergence of reactionary movements in nerd subcultures, from the sad puppies in speculative fiction to Gamergate in video games. And we looked at how some of those movements had begun to bleed over into Dungeons and Dragons, but had not really begun to awaken. Today, we will experience that awakening.
Yeah, our first episode, and apologies if you only care about exclusively Dungeons and Dragons related information, because it was setting up, I think, very necessary contextual information for thinking about and learning about and knowing about these reactionary gamers. But now we are finally able to talk about the burgeoning reaction to change, evolution, progressive elements of D&D, and the reaction is small but loud, hard to ignore, and in some corners, very powerful.
If there's a theme to today's episode, I think it's that reaction doesn't just come from below. And I think that Robin quote is instructive in that reaction and reactionary goals often align with the interests of people and organizations and ideologies that are already in power. And they're more than willing to stoke, co-opt, influence, guide. AstroTurf is a term you'll hear a lot.
Yep.
Movements that maybe don't have a lot of traction, but can be signal boosted by powerful right-wing media interests and, today, influencers. And I think, I don't know, that's my kind of hypothesis as what might be happening here a little bit. We'll see if the evidence bears it out.
Well, and this is a tell, and this is how you can know if you're dealing with a reactionary, generally, is they will employ whatever language they feel like, often language of inclusion or progression or social justice, but what they are materially in service to is existing hierarchies, right? This is the obnoxious and sinister thing about Elon Musk's takeover of Twitter or Joe Rogan's anti-establishment rhetoric is the words that they use, the phrases that they employ, you know, sound appealing if you're somebody who's just sort of like generally anti-authoritarian or libertarian minded. But ultimately, people like that end up serving the interests of those in power and end up serving existing hierarchies. It's very, very simple. And while you need to pay attention to what people are really accomplishing rather than what they say they care about.
To set the stage, we're up to the year 2018. D&D, especially Dungeons & Dragons 5th edition, is doing great. It is, you know, by now far and away the most popular role-playing game in the world, once again. New material is coming out infrequently, but it's always on the bestseller list. Actual plays are peaking the Twitch charts for, you know, really the first time. A little podcast called Dungeon Master of None is out, and there's about 5 listeners for it.
It's a burgeoning and exciting time to be early adopter of Dungeon Master of None.
Right. Shout out to our 5 listeners who are listening to us in May 2018. Fifth edition's most recent release in May 2018 was Mordenkainen's Tome of Foes. And we reviewed it on this show. We thought it was, you know, a pretty decent book. It was a hit. But here is where we also have a technological shift in the way reaction is expressed on the right, in that YouTube becomes like a pretty big center for people on the right complaining about media.
Yeah, it's easy to forget because everything kind of blends together, and YouTube has been around for a very long time. But YouTube has evolved frequently, and of late a particularly lucrative field for YouTubers is bitching about social justice or progressivism in media. And Matt has some specific examples, but I'm sure you're all familiar with the outrage machine that fires into full effect whenever there's a lady in Star Wars or Marvel in a way that, you know, people don't like.
You're getting a little ahead of yourself here.
Oh, sorry.
Don't do a teleology here, Rob, because that, yeah, it's just not going on yet. But we're seeing the first... You're definitely...
The point I was trying to make is this is going to lead
to some of those things. But again, don't get ahead of yourself.
The point I was trying to make was that that was not always the case. Those people were always there. But the, if you don't remember, the heady days of 2018, it was not always such.
Mordenkainen's Tomophos was a hit. But on page 44, there was something that caused a bit of a stir, again, among reactionary circles. And compared to the gender-inclusive-ish language in the player's handbook generated a lot more outrage than the player's handbook. Two paragraphs in a section on the elves in Mordenkainen's Tomophos describe, quote, the blessed of Corellian, who, to summarize, are born androgynous or non-binary, and some of them, the text explains, can change their sex over a long rest. So I think this shows the difference between the kind of tacit grumbling, but really not a lot of bitching over the player's handbook and what starts being talked about in 2018. Here is the first of our many, many, many weird reactionary D&D YouTubers. Here's a clip from, quote, the SJW Fifi Fest over D&D is nigh. Take it away, weird guy.
And so this ability called Corellon's Blessing, which has been around for a while, actually, this is not something new, allows an elf to kind of shift their biological sex from man to woman or woman to man. And the book isn't even fucking released yet, and already there's people getting pissed off about this and how it represents gender identity and how it promotes this cis-heteronormative blah 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 fucking word salad bullshit that the Tumblrites and the Bizuo and the SJWs want to fucking bitch about. Look, let me fucking set the record straight here. Dungeons and Dragons is whatever the fuck you want it to be. If it's not as fucking inclusive as you want it to goddamn be, then you fucking make it more fucking inclusive. For God's sake, okay. When I was DMing games at the fucking comic book store for game night, I had people coming in with fucking half-dragon furries and shit. And I didn't give two fucking flying fucks.
Okay.
Just let them play their fucking character and have their goddamn fun. That's what we were fucking there for.
This is
per our agreement.
Yeah.
I went into this blind, listeners. So yeah. I Matt has heard this before. I have not. Sorry, just so that you know, not that you need to like look this up or anything, but this is, I think, is relevant information. This YouTuber's name is Weaponized Nerd Rage.
Sure. Yes. And he sounds exactly like you would imagine someone who has the term or name title Weaponized Nerd Rage.
Right. So he's upset because some people, and I didn't see this, so I'm sure it happened, but it was not visible to me. Some people are complaining or complained that Mordenkainen's Tomophos reinforced the gender binary by allowing these elves with Corellon's blessing of Corellon to change their sex. Is that what I'm... Am I understanding what he's complaining about correctly?
If I understand, yes. He is complaining that, one, that this blessing exists. He calls it Corellian's blessing, not the blessed of Corellian. But he's also complaining that some people provided a critique of how the language was written. And here's why I picked this video is if you could... you know, get the argument over all of the, like, just, you know, more fuck words than you really need to drive your point home.
He's much angrier than he needs to be about anything involved here. Nothing justifies being this angry. I sorry.
This is the basic, like,
about this.
This is the basic reactionary argument, number one, which is that if you complain or critique or add a suggestion about anything related to a game, like, you know, fuck you, you're being a baby. Just make your game whatever you want it to be, right? Mm-hmm. Stop complaining and forcing other people to do anything.
Yeah, this is a great example, Matt, because we talked about this extensively on the first part of this episode, but this is exactly it. What he's most upset about is the critique, right? He's not really responding to the substance of the critique or the ability itself. What he's clearly, like, demonstrably furious about is that somebody complained about the Blessed of Corellon. The thing is that sometimes these complaints are annoying. I don't have a strong feeling one way or another. Sometimes social justice or progressive critiques can feel obnoxious, but you can respond to them or not. You can ignore them. Wizards does all the time. And so it's always bewildering to me when... And here's the thing, Matt. Sorry. In order for this dude to have this to discuss, he had to have sought this out. He had to have been looking for somebody complaining in, like, a social justice way about this book. Like, there's no way. Again, Matt, were you aware of this particular critique? It now, like, makes a certain degree of sense to me. I don't know that I agree or disagree, but
I mean,
I
remember reading the Blessed of Corellon when we reviewed Mordenkainen's Tome of Foes, but I don't think we even brought it up.
I don't think we talked about elves because I was really bored by the elves section. I distinctly remember skipping the elves section because we had too much else to talk about. Sorry, the point I'm making here is that in order to know about this, to dunk on it, to get mad about it, you must be looking for it, right? And right. That's another thing about reactionary thought is that they're acting like, oh, these people are coming into our spaces and they're changing things. This is what it's about. But they very frequently are looking for, deliberately seeking out things to get enraged about. Or they follow people who do that. This is kind of the libs of TikTok model. Like, this person finds the most quote unquote outrageous examples of LGBTQ, you know, extreme behavior, and then broadcasts it to millions of people so they can get pissed off and act like this is suddenly a major problem. Anyway, sorry, I have little respect for weaponized nerd rage because he's just trying to find something to get pissed off about. Like, you're just, like, making yourself angry, dude. Like, chill out.
Every video is like this, but I think this is the argument number one is that how dare you critique, suggest, try and improve the game in any way, because you can just make it whatever you want at your table. And you'll often see people be like, yes, I had the most diverse person at my table, right? Oh, I had a furry at my table, as the video maker claims, right? Sort of missing that. Yeah, sure, that's fine. But, you know, you can do both things, right? You know,
right,
you can still do whatever you want at your own table. But yeah, if something could be better, maybe it could also be made better. So again, here's the point is that, again, this is, like, actually kind of from May 2018 or early the first half of 2018. This is, like, one of the few YouTube videos like this that I could find. And I want to contrast this with the next two sort of clips here. Paizo, let's not forget that still in 2018, it was a little bit up in the air, like, fifth edition had taken over, but for the past couple of years before that, Pathfinder had been going neck and neck as the most popular type of fantasy RPG. And Paizo has not always been perfect or not always even been great, but they really have made some amazing attempts at trying to be a more diverse and inclusive rule set and welcoming space. And they, in 2018, I found several videos in which they had come under fire for basically being cool. So this is from September 2018 in a video titled Paizo Goes Woke. And here's the first time I could find, like, woke associated with a role-playing game. Actually, the video title is Pathfinder Going Extra Woke, But Already Doomed to Brokenness, from September 2018.
Sorry, I just want to, I think it's important that we highlight that this is from friend of the pod, Casimir Urbanski, RPG pundit, whose Dark Albion role-playing game we discussed in like, well, in like 2018, I think.
Yes.
He sucks, but yeah.
Yeah, his real name is John Tanarski, a.k.a. Swaim Ig Sigma. He also has a YouTube channel where he claims he is a real magician. Okay, here we go.
This isn't new for Paizo. They've been infested with SJWs. Jessica Price worked at Paizo, you know, one of the most hateful
Jessica Price
women in the history of gaming, right? Just
I'm
someone
sorry,
who's just
this
a detestable
this is
human
deep
being.
Lore.
Yeah, yeah.
Sorry, Jessica Price was a writer for Guild Wars 2.
Yes.
And I think she got fired at, again, she got canceled by the right. I already
right,
forgot.
This was kind of like
for.
A Gamergate adjacent thing, if I remember.
Gamergate adjacent. It was
fallout.
Late because I think this was 2018 or 2019 when this happened. I only know about this because I unfortunately know too much about Gamergate and I played Guild Wars 2.
You were a big Guild Wars guy.
I was a Guild Wars head, not the point, but like when people talk about cancellations, there are lots of left wing people getting canceled too. And Jessica Price lost her job because a bunch of right wing dipshits got mad at her over something she said on Twitter. I don't remember what it was. It probably wasn't bad. Anyway, sorry. He's fucking furious about Jessica Price. Wild stuff. Continue.
And who has nothing but contempt for gamers. And she was running half the show there. But they've listened to these people who have been trying to convince them that if you just make a game that is more SJW than D&D, let's face it, D&D 5th edition is not lacking its, you know, inclusion and diversity and its, you know, proper pronouns, right? So, like, they're going to have to try really hard, and it looks like they're doing it, to be more politically correct than 5th edition, to be able to look at 5th edition and say, look at those right-wing shitlords that play 5th edition, you know? So this is going to be funny, really, the way I see it. It's not going to work. Paizo's going to go bankrupt because they're not using the right strategy. They're
narrator's note, Paizo's best year financially, the last reported year, 2021.
Trying to pretend they still matter. They just don't matter anymore. They should have scaled down, but they didn't. And it's going to be funny, though, watching people from Paizo alienate completely these heavy crunch gamers that loved Pathfinder, who are pretty much the opposite of the target market of the SJW crowd, right? They're just going to be treated with complete contempt and told, we don't want you. We're going to make a bright new glorious future by, you know, making Pathfinder the game that mostly, you know, black trans lesbians play. And somehow we're going to make a profit off that. And, you know, in the time between when they destroy their customer base and go bankrupt, it's going to be really funny watching them trying to suggest that they're the true woke gaming company and Wizards is somehow, you know, full of Trump supporters or something like that. You know,
I find this video very funny.
Sorry, I laughed out loud in the middle of it. It is very funny. It's funny. Matt is right. It's funny. It's a funny video.
Right. So that in 2018, I just want to note that here we have a right wing YouTube personality saying that, you know, we're contrasting woke Paizo with basically like good D&D, you know, acknowledging that like D&D is somewhat woke, but not as woke as Paizo. And so I just want to point out this video for one, getting things incredibly wrong. Paizo has been actually pretty successful over the last 4 years. But I think it brings up the broader point is that for like 3 years after the release of 5th edition, so like 2015, 2016, 17, and into 18, like people from the old gamer community, and this particular person is from the OSR community, sort of, really seemed to like 5th edition.
For a while, they thought it was their game or that it was aimed at them. It had a lot of hallmarks of old school gaming.
I just want to cite here the blog A Night at the Opera did some really great basically blog and post archaeology and compiled 10 or 12 like leading old school or old style gamer posts about how like 5th edition was old school and great and a return of D&D to greatness. No sort of like, you know, what we might see later in this episode about 5th edition.
It's just funny how divorced from reality this person's perception of events and the world is. And this is quite common. But, you know, describing Jessica Price as somebody with nothing but contempt for gamers.
Person who works at a game company.
She works at a game company. Like, I think this is like a common belief, but like, he doesn't ever explicitly say this, but it is clear in his mind, and I believe it is clear in the minds of many reactionary gamers, that if you are a traditional nerd who likes wargaming or crunchy games or mechanical games, that is contrasted to if you are a SJW. You cannot be queer, you cannot be have purple hair, you cannot be trans and like wargaming or mechanics or anything. I mean, Pathfinder 2 remains one of the crunchiest tactical RPGs on the market.
Yeah.
It's great. And it is still, this is the wild thing. It is very
the crazy
inclusive.
Thing is, it's maybe crunchier than first edition. It's just better designed.
It's just better designed. It's ridiculous on the face of it, but you can tell that in his mind, there's some sort of like axis, right? And on one end of it, you have black trans lesbians, right? And on the other hand, you have nerdy, crunchy gamers. But the two have nothing to do with each other. Like it's like apples and oranges, right? But you can, again, I think this is very telling. There's the belief that the people who play games, who play a certain type of game, are a certain type of person, right? And, you know, it's almost like a meme on the internet how much trans women like, you know, EU4 and other like heavy strategic games. Like it's a joke on Twitter. But like it's clear that, and they would never say this because it's just sort of like one of those assumed beliefs that goes unexamined, but that there's a certain type of person who likes tactical board games, tactical RPGs. And if you are a progressive, maybe even if you're a woman, it depends on how like self-aware they are. You can't possibly be interested in any of these things. You must be trying to destroy it from within. You must have contempt for gamers. You must be trying to change it. It's I think this stuff is very, very telling when they reveal their hand like that.
I think it just like with Gamergate, it sort of shows what it's sort of deeply felt belief is among reactionaries, like deep in their feelings and psychology, because you could have like a white guy write a bunch of weird RPGs about feelings or about, you know, the apocalypse or about being Mormons in the desert, and you don't get the same kind of hate, like you're trying to destroy gaming. Maybe sometimes you do, but it's not. But you can have Jessica Price, a woman who writes at the most normal crunchy game company in the world, and Guild Wars and Pathfinder, and it's like, oh yeah, you're just trying to destroy this. Okay, so Rob, I mentioned like all these kind of grassroots things, but I think the, you know, illustrated by our opening prologue quote, reaction very rarely or never just comes from below. In mid-2018, Breitbart, a right-wing blog/news site, published a very interesting article. And so far, I've highlighted a few grassroots reactionary shitheads. But reactionary ideas are not a bottom-up thing. Far from it. Here's what I think is a huge turning point from none other than Breitbart. So this article, Rob, is titled Stanford Professor, Dungeons and Dragons Perpetuate Systems of White Male Privilege. And this is, I think, kind of typical of Breitbart articles. Maybe they read the abstract of an article published in who knows what academic publication, and then generate clicks out of it. Rob, will you read that like third paragraph of the article that starts with Garcia argues?
Sure. Garcia argues that Dungeons & Dragons encourages a distrust of the other, in quotes. It's a weird focus for a Stanford scholar, especially since Garcia... I'm sorry. Just the style of writing on right-wing sites. It's a weird focus for a Stanford scholar, especially since Garcia concedes that race in Dungeons & Dragons is not much like race in the real world. In the game, the characters are divided by their species. Some characters are elves, some are dwarves, and some are halflings, according to Garcia.
Professor Garcia doesn't stop there. He bemoans the fact that Dungeons & Dragons began as a, quote, white man's hobby. He argues that wargaming communities are, quote, male-dominated, unquote, even though this wasn't the intention of the game's designer, who initially tested the tabletop game out on his daughter. I guess they're referring to Gary Gygax playing with his daughter.
Is that Gygax?
Yeah, Gygax played with his daughter.
I don't know that that's as strong of a... I don't know.
So Rob, I've linked the article. I don't know if you had a chance to read it, but it doesn't really seem to matter that much. We'll get to the actual contents of the article in a second.
Yeah, I read the article. It's good. It doesn't really say what Breitbart says that it says.
No, it doesn't say that.
It doesn't surprising.
It doesn't say that gaming encourages a distrust of the other. It talks about the difference between like online play and tabletop play, and the relationship between our real world culture and the culture we build in our imaginations. It doesn't really say that like one is, it just says these are connected. It's a long article.
It's part of cultural reproduction, right? Like this is one of the most, again, in my opinion, like obvious and least offensive ideas you can come up with in sort of cultural studies, is that
It's a super unoffensive article, right?
If the idea that anything that's not explicitly politics can have a political effect, then yes, it's offensive. But like the idea that you reproduce the culture in which you exist when you play games, you know, in that culture in a certain fashion, that's just a very like basic, again, completely innocuous idea. Like it's like saying that like when you raise the temperature of water to a certain point, it boils. Like it's just, I mean, to the extent that anything can be obvious in the social sciences, this is obvious.
The other like main focus of the article that Professor Garcia spends a lot of time doing is he just did like some simple counts of the art in the core books and whether it depicted men and women in the art, women or men, and just sort of did a count of like how much of the art depicts like women heroes as opposed to male heroes. And he just shows that early art mostly depicts men, later editions depict slightly more women, but even up to the current edition, there's still more men depicted in the art than women. And then he just, you know, says, yeah, that's the counts. You know, it's very, very inoffensive stuff. The point of this is that like these articles serve, you know, to really rile up the base, I guess, in this symbiotic relationship of, you know, we've got some people on the grassroots generating outrage, and then Breitbart can do it too. I mean, we have a lot of comments on this Breitbart article by, you know, people saying, mockingly, half orc lives matter. You know, this is, you know, look on my privilege in despair that this is, you know, the liberal people are at it again, attacking our precious Dungeons and Dragons.
This article is like six paragraphs long, and three of them are like a sentence. Like, there's barely anything here. This is, in terms of effort to outrage, this is high return on investment. No wonder Breitbart published it.
These things kind of have a life cycle.
Sorry, Matt, just a second. This is a great example of what I mean when I say you have to be looking for it, right? Somebody either has a Google alert set up or is just like trawling through recently published papers looking for something that they can put on Breitbart and get pissed off about. Like, people publish, you have no idea how much shit academics publish every year that nobody reads. Every now and then somebody will dig up something and they'll be like, look at what these professors are saying. And I'm like, boy, if you knew what else they were saying, you'd be fucking furious. But nobody reads that shit. Anyway, it's just wild.
But these articles kind of have a cycle, right? There'll be the outrage article published, and then other right-wing influencers will pick it up. We're going to hear next, and this is also from 2018, from Michelle Malkin. If you don't know who Michelle Malkin is, I'm just going to read. I'm doing real low effort here. Just going to read.
I can't stand this lady.
The paragraph on Wikipedia. Around 2019, Malkin began to publicly support members of the extreme right, including Nick Fuentes. Malkin has faced criticism from journalism and activism organizations for association with white nationalists, neo-Nazis, Groypers, including Fuentes, and Identity Europa leader Patrick Casey. In November 2019, she was dropped by the conservative organization Young America's Foundation, citing her support for individuals associated with anti-Semitism and white nationalism. So here's a video from Michelle Malkin that had many, many, many views. This is from Facebook.
Oh, hey, you caught me in full geek mode. I'm prepping a new Dungeons & Dragons session for my family. But get this. According to a Stanford University professor, what we're all really doing when we play D&D is perpetuating systems of white privilege and male domination. I shizzle you not. Social justice warriors are the biggest party poopers on the planet. Thanks to the folks at Breitbart Tech, we now know that Stanford education professor Antero Garcia spends his days in the ivory tower concocting ways to paint us gamers as cultural oppressors. Garcia's new scholarly paper.
Okay, Michelle, you're a gamer.
Racial and gender identities in tabletop role-playing games. His abstract asserts that, quote, by focusing on
depictions of gender,
race, and power in Dungeons & Dragons as a singular cultural practice, this study highlights how researchers must attend to cultural production both around and within systems. Is this dude speaking Elvish? Because I have no idea what he's saying.
One okay joke.
Garcia
there.
Also gave a recent related lecture on Dungeons & Dragons in an era of terror, nationalism, and Gamergate. Apparently, he sits in his comfy perch at Stanford, sifting through D&D manuals, counting photos of women
to Stanford?
Collect as evidence of sexism.
This guy's an assistant professor, right?
In a fantasy game.
Yeah, okay.
He's not does this guy even have tenure? Sorry, Michelle.
Yeah,
interrupting.
That's enough of that. So,
I'm sorry, my favorite part of that was she was like, you know, oh, hello, I didn't see you there. I'm just preparing my regular game of Dungeons & Dragons for my family. Like,
right. Oh, you caught me in geek mode. Oh, Jesus Christ.
You caught me in geek mode. Like, do you remember, Dodgeball? When Ben Stiller's character is he's like, oh, hello, you just caught me reading the dictionary. I like to do that to brush up, you got to keep the minds a muscle, too. Anyway, yeah. It's just like.
Oh, sorry.
Okay. Sorry. It's so fucking stupid. Sorry. Okay.
It's really dumb. Like, Michelle Malkin, like, truly, you know, a terrible right-wing person, right? But, you know, this was a very, very popular video on YouTube. And I guess it's just, it's sort of framing the debate as I see these right-wing leaders like Malkin, like Breitbart, trying to define D&D as the next possible space to bring the culture war to.
Yeah. Well, and it's hilarious to me that they have now decided to adopt it as their, or they briefly tried to adopt it as their space when it used to be a very popular target for right-wing outrage. I don't know that this took. I feel like right-wing mainstream has tacked back to D&D as part of the broader witchcraft, Satanism, you know, undercurrent in America. But there was a moment when they were like, oh, we can use this. Yeah. And it didn't really take.
Just to mention the article that drew like reactionary rage from outside the typical like D&D blogosphere and emerging right wing YouTube sphere. Like the article itself is, again, mostly just saying I did some thinking about how to think about studying tabletop role-playing games as opposed to video games, which get a lot more academic attention. You know, in my opinion, the article just draws attention to communities around a game and the game and calls for researching games within their broader socio-cultural space and like how local metagames shape in-game play. Like, it's, again, like some very basic stuff, right? And then, as we mentioned before, there's a simple analysis of gender representation in the art of D&D and shows how, you know, especially in the past, it was pretty biased towards men. And this is sort of supporting his point, or Professor Garcia's point, about how the system and rules and the text that players are presented matter, but so do the cultural baggage that players bring to a game. Again, that's basically all the game or the article is saying.
This is so common in the right-wing outrage space, but if you've never read an academic paper before, then a lot of this stuff sounds just totally extreme and outrageous, but it's just...
One great joke about is this guy speaking Elvish. Yes, academics are bad writers. You got us there.
But like, talking about privilege and power in Dungeons & Dragons... I think that's very interesting. This was a very interesting article. It was worth looking into. Does it really, like, he comes to a conclusion, but I don't even know that he's making a particularly powerful point. He's not trying
to. He's just like, being like, this is an introduction to maybe we should study this some more.
It's just an analysis. Like, there's really very little, like, condemnation or criticism. And everything that could be critical is pretty straightforward. He's like, look, here's how many pictures there were of women. That's not very many. Like that. Like
here's how they describe races. They're often described in weird ways. He just like quotes how different races, like for example, half orcs, are described in fifth edition, right? Or how the monk class is described.
Yeah. Again, I do understand why you might find this angering if you are a D&D fan who doesn't want to think too hard about it, but it's just so weird to focus on this instead of ignoring it. Like, if I guess this is my thing about reactionary gamers is like, do you really like to play games? Like, why are you spending all your time online bitching instead of just like playing? Like, I don't know. Like, why are you so mad about this? Like, does it impact your play? Because I don't see how it possibly could. And why is this the focus of your ire anyway?
I think we see in 2018 and 2019 an uptick in that when I was, you know, again, doing some YouTube archaeology, is that there are now lots and lots of videos basically about every, like about this article, about every new Dungeons and Dragons book, that sort of approach it from a very reactionary point of view, being like, I'm mad about the thing that was published. And we just really didn't see that before with fifth edition or with any type of D&D. Here's a video from October 2019. This video isn't available anymore. Okay. it's deleted. Let's try that again. Here's a video from September 2019, a reaction to the wonderful free PDF that we read on the show, Consent in Gaming.
One, Ace here, and today I have some absolute cringe to inform you all about, and this comes from the realms of pen and paper games. For as you see, an organization called Monte Cook Games has decided to publish a new manual called Consent in Gaming, which can be best described as a guide for social justice warriors on how best to sabotage private gaming groups. Not only is it filled with the sort of pearl-clenching drivel that you might expect from such a manual, but it even comes complete with consent forms that the GM is supposed to print out and hand to players, which is so detailed and extreme that it even goes so far as to ask players whether or not they're comfortable with fighting spiders or rats. Additionally, and perhaps just as telling, this 11-page manual even dedicates an entire page and a half to the proper procedure of performing an apology to the perpetually offended. Furthermore, this particular manual also dedicates another entire page to the concept of a pen and paper version of the military stress card, and even takes it a step further by also providing another half a page to the concept.
God, that was so tedious to listen to.
I love this video because he calls it Monte Cook Game.
He doesn't know anything.
Monty Cook.
He's not,
his name's Monty.
This guy's not even a real gamer. Yeah. I'm going to gatekeep right now. Yeah. This guy doesn't know anything about TTRPGs and he just shut his mouth.
Right.
Some right-wingers at least know how to present, how to speak. But like the ones who just sort of like drone into their microphones, God, they're so fucking boring. So boring, dude. Do better.
It's interesting here that like this is like a basically one of the many professional Gamergate people, right, who are now, like you said, just kind of looking for things to get mad about. And here's one, you know, notice he says here, this comes from pen and paper games, right? Clearly right, doesn't know who Monty Cook is.
He's mainly a gamer, a video gamer.
And that, you know, describing consent in gaming as something to for social justice warriors to try and destroy games, as opposed to a nice thing that you can include if you want to promote, you know, consent and avoid like, you know, things that your players don't want to experience in your game. I love that he brought up the example of spiders, right? Which is like of all of the things on the list, the one thing in the past that like I've had players freak out about, right? Because I've had a player that had, you know, an intense fear of spiders and couldn't hear description of spiders, right? Anyway, I found another short video that a lot of this, and this is, I think, my sort of next supporting argument for, I think, where reaction is going. And I'm going to quote here. Actually, Rob, why don't you read this in your nerd voice?
There's a certain faction in the SJW hashtag D&D hobby desperate to mingle concepts from BDSM fetishism into hashtag TTRPG play.
I guess referring here that ideas of like putting consent out at the forefront, saying they come from the BDSM community here. And I just notice a lot of stuff about the leftists are trying to stick like corrupting sex in front of people who play, especially children. Here's a comment from a video. Right-wing people have searched out Professor Garcia of Stanford University and have left all kinds of nasty comments on his YouTube video. Here's one. This is the guy behind the new D&D after school kits, where he wants kids in grade 4 to, quote, try out different identities. Yeah, this isn't going to be used to transition kids without parental consent or knowledge.
All right, hang on. I'm doing some sleuthing here.
Okay.
Notice how this commenter says grade 4. That is not how Americans refer to fourth grade. This is an international anti-SJW. This is some Australian, Brit or like Hungarian.
Possibly Canadian.
You know, getting pissed off about shit that has nothing to do with them, building the outrage. You see this all the time. They give themselves away. They don't know how to use American lingo. And they comment on this shit. And I'm like, dude, why do you fucking care what a Stanford professor is doing? Like, they're not transitioning your kids in Poland, buddy. Sorry.
Right.
What are you going to say, Matt?
These last two comments, like, why should you care if something came from the BDSM community unless you're trying to drive up, like, a moral panic about sex,
right,
or about, in the case of this last comment, about gender identity. So I think we're starting to become full circle and where the, at least on the right among reactionaries, that they are scared of the new wave of D&D because, again, it's corrupting the children. We can't expose children to this.
Right. And Matt, Matt's right to make this point. And I think it's worth thinking about how when the reactionary right sees a mention of gender, an innocuous, just addressing the fact that gender exists and perhaps it's malleable, or the idea of consent, immediately they assign that a sexual motive that has to be related to sex or intimacy or eroticism that it is impossible for them to conceive of. Or if a child identifies as a boy or a girl, regardless of their plumbing, that's sex. That's horny. That's erotic. That's got to do with fucking, right?
Yeah.
Or if somebody mentioned consent, that's gotta have to do with doing the sex. And they cannot conceive of addressing sex or gender or consent in a non-erotic, in non-sexual fashion. It is incomprehensible to them because their brains are full of smut, Matt. Conservatives are, yeah. their minds are filthy. Sorry. I don't want to say it's all projection, but I don't know, it's a lot of projection.
It might be a little bit of projection. So here's the other thread I pick up in how the reaction memesphere evolves, in that it's all just about outrage generation. So this is a video about someone commenting on just whatever the latest controversy in D&D is. And Rob, you and I know all these because we also follow these, but you know, mostly not to get mad about them. This is from when the Candlekeep Mysteries came out, and one of the freelance authors complained about the edits that WotC had made to their adventure.
This person, and none of it's true. Holy crap, did they change the story without his permission? Which, I mean, I guess depending upon what the contract said, but the dude's pissed, and basically he wants his name taken off of it. He's like, this is so changed, and it's so offensive to my, like, actual original ideas and like, accuracy to even D&D lore that he doesn't want anything to do with it. And take a guess if the changes they made were them SJWing it up and making some bullshit political statement. Why, yes, that is what they did. But they didn't just throw darts at a board and say, okay, everybody it hits, they're now gay. Or at least he's not saying that that's what they did. I fully expect that that's what they did. Amongst some of the complaints are the UNT are now universally evil for evil's sake. They're one dimensional.
This guy says the changes were made by WotC as part of their evil SJW agenda. The description to the video says, quote, a guy wrote a story, WotC staff dumbed it down into an SJW soap opera about British imperialism. You can feel the outrage in this video, right, Rob?
Yes. I love that he did his own nerd voice. He didn't have to do it. This guy was, he's so mad about the WotC changing everything.
So the story that this video presents is that someone wrote a beautiful, basically module for Candlekeep Mystery, and the corrupt SJWs at WotC destroyed it by making it dumb and SJW and political. Here's a little, you know, insert the Curb Your Enthusiasm music. Rob, will you read this comment by this guy that he had to post a couple months later?
Upon further research after this video was done in coding, I found that the author is a paranoid victim complex race-baiting scumbag who was whining about how Tasha's Cauldron didn't fix racism in D&D, and he was likely part of the vocal idiots pushing for the utterly idiotic changes made to the races in D&D lately. He loses all credibility. His writing is likely complete shit, and he's just playing the victim again because WotC didn't like his work. Boo hoo!
Really,
he lost all
guy.
Credibility when I found out about his little online protest campaign, all about seeing racism everywhere, especially in places where it's not.
So, Rob, I think your point about this is all just about generating outrage for outrage's sake a lot of times completely illustrated here. This person never read the adventure or the changes in the first place. They just made a video, assumed that WotC was the SJW, and this author was a brave writer fighting for apolitical just gaming, when in fact, the author's complaints had nothing to do with this type of things. And if you wanted to read it that way, in fact, the roles were completely reversed. Once he found out that the roles were reversed, actually, our author goes from brave free speech hero to idiot like that on a dime.
Mm-hmm. This is this Book of Cylinders?
This was, yes, Book of Cylinders.
I remember reading about this one. This was disappointing because I think the author was trying to recreate or reestablish the lore for the Gripply. Wizards removed a bunch of their very good suggestions, and yeah. I think they honestly they were right to want their name taken off of this. I mean, I remember reading about what they had tried to do, and Book of Cylinders is a totally fine adventure, but it would have been much more interesting if they had been allowed to make them into a real...
Publish the full thing.
Yeah.
Rob, I'm sure you have this question, and you've had it for a long time. Can you be classical and play Dungeons & Dragons?
I've often wondered, Matt.
And we also played D&D tonight. So my husband and I play Dungeons & Dragons with a few of our friends. And I know it's a little bit nerdy, but I actually really like it. As somebody who grew up and loved Lord of the Rings, loved it. Seriously, if anyone wants to talk about the movies with me in the comments, let's get a conversation started. I love the idea of Dungeons & Dragons because you're getting to live in this fantasy world, which is super cool. So I play a druid and I'm an elf and it's really fun. And my husband is playing a bard and he has based his character off of Pavarotti. It's hilarious and he is so funny. So in tonight's game, one of the things that we had to do on our quest was fight a dragon. And this dragon had a skeleton on its back that was riding him.
More conservative influencers getting into D&D. This video is just kind of an outlier.
People are going to accuse us of being horny on Maine, putting classically Abby in our podcast. I think we may have transgressed a boundary.
Oh
here.
No, I found it amusing in that yes, classical Abby is a not maybe a reactionary influencer, but a conservative one, and wanted to relay a story about D&D about her husband's character. So
I'm still stuck on the way that she announced Pavarotti. I know you're a classically trained violinist or sure. whatever, but like, this is America, lady. Pronounce everyone's foreign name wrong. That's how we do it here.
This is, I think,
Pavarotti.
Interesting in that, yeah, we've seen, at least the, like, this is from a, like, I think a religious conservative.
Yes.
Saying that, no, Dungeons & Dragons is not demonic. It's actually classical to play it. Same with Michelle Malkin.
A lot of you probably don't know this. This was Abby Shapiro. This is Ben Shapiro's sister, who has built her own brand on being classically trained and a classic lady, and enjoying. She's a trad wife, basically.
Yeah.
But anyway, so that's relevant context. And she, I don't know what her videos are about. Just stuff. Apparently,
we've made it. We've gotten classical. We've made it to the year 2020, right? Basically,
right.
The present day.
Right.
And I think in the last from 2016 to 2020, we saw the emergence of like a right wing commentator on Dungeons and Dragons from both above and below emerge. Right. You just like didn't have this at the same level. There's not really an organization like we saw with Gamergate or with Sad Puppies, but like all the views are there and they've kind of been democratized. Maybe they don't really need a movement. People are just doing it on their own, generating clicks and generating outrage, much of it completely made up, as we saw in that one example.
This is an interesting time online because D&D, as we all know, is having a moment. It's been having a moment for about a decade now. You know, the emergence, reemergence has been pretty significant. But every year, every 3 months, something big happens. There's a new D&D movie on the way. The cast of Critical Role is on the front page of Esquire or something. Like, I don't know which of these things happened in 2020, but we are mid-pandemic, peak pandemic, and people are inside a lot. And they are playing online, and D&D is more popular, and more people are on YouTube and on TikTok. And a consequence of all of these changes is, yeah, what Matt said, the emergence of an offshoot, a hideous little polyp budding out of the video game ragosphere to try to capitalize on the same type of outrage about Dungeons and Dragons specifically.
Quote, use 5e if you're looking to play an old school style D&D game, but don't actually want to deal with old school mechanical stuff like class based to hit lookup tables and want the official D&D version for such a game. I bring that quote up in that old school gamers in the early years of 5th edition seem to really like 5th edition, but you know, 2017, 2018, thanks to Breitbart, thanks to also some kind of more grassroots reactionary people, Dungeons and Dragons, or at least the concept of D&D, begins to be lumped in together with SJW, or, and we saw this word just once or twice here, woke companies, which is kind of a broader trend, right? We've seen this among the reaction right. in many different things. X company is woke, Y company is woke, Z company is not woke and therefore good.
Well, and I think that part of this is that, and this has been true since the release of 5th edition, but the player base for D&D is younger, more diverse, and more queer friendly than it ever has been before. And it is possible that it is majority so, or extreme majority so. And this is obvious if you are involved in any living TTRPG communities. But I think it was easy to ignore, or easier to mm-hmm. ignore until a recent point. And I think that around this time, many of the old school gamers suddenly realized that in their space,
the most popular streaming shows have women, have people of color,
have women, have people of color,
have different gender and sexual orientations.
Exactly. Yeah. The Adventure Zone, Critical Role. Yeah. You couldn't ignore it anymore. It was impossible for, again, our outraged gamers, our RPG pundits to not realize that 5th edition, which they thought was theirs. And this is also, again, speaking of wizards tripping on their dick, this is also when wizards started to realize it too. And then they fumbled the bag repeatedly trying to appease badly the people who were
you're
like,
getting
hey,
ahead of ourselves. All this. That's okay.
More on that next week. The point is, something changes around 2020. And Matt's correct to sort of like point this as an inflection point.
So I chose the quote at the beginning of the episode is because Robin brings up this idea of the private life of power. And if you're looking for something more serious than this episode, I highly recommend reading his book, The Reactionary Mind. And this idea is that like conservatism and reaction are about protecting private spheres of power. Boss over employee, husband over wife, parent over child, right? In a sense, like, you know, tabletop games are a very private life, right? For most people, you think about them on your own, you play them in a living room with friends, feeling that private life threatened. It doesn't matter if nothing is changing in your actual group. You can see gender-inclusive language in a D&D rulebook, an academic study on how D&D has some sexist elements, especially in its past, or seeing people playing your game who do not look like you, and assuming that, as Rob said in episode one, they're going to exclude you from your space and punish or dominate you like you have imagined you have done to others in the past.
So Matt and I, like many left-wing thinkers, I'm going to call us that even though we don't deserve it, just for making a point here. We like to take right-wing thought seriously, and I think it's worth taking seriously, even though it is often ridiculous. But I think what's really important to understand and why you should take it seriously, but it does not need to be indulged in any way, is that if you don't go looking for this, if you don't know anything about it, nothing has changed materially. Nothing has changed meaningfully for a right-wing reactionary gamer playing 5th edition or any other edition of D&D in their personal space. I suppose that maybe
Rob,
when they...
Is it as if a metagame and the broader social cultural setting is somehow influencing what's happening at a table, as Professor Antonio Garcia might argue?
it might be. Perhaps there's something to that. Oh, I mean, I suppose that like if you go to your friendly local gaming store, you might see more art with women or people of color in it. But aside from that, there's no reason why you have to care or engage with or why any of this should affect you at all, which is why you don't have to take these people seriously and why they don't need to be catered to, because nothing will make them happy, because there's nothing that could be changed to make them happy, because nothing has changed for them. They are mad about things changing in a space that they are sort of a part of, that doesn't impact the way that they play a game or the way that they live their lives. They just are mad about other people existing visibly. And there's nothing that can be done about that. And I also want to point out that anybody who was really serious about this type of thing, whether it's in gaming or in just sort of like broader politics, just think about what the end result of that ideology is. Think about, like, if they get everything that they want, what that looks like. You know, it doesn't look good.
Rob, thanks for sticking with me on part two of our journey.
Oh, I'm having a great time.
You're not going anywhere. I got you locked in. I got the little things from Clockwork Orange inserted into your
That's
eyeballs.
Right.
We've got more right wingers coming up. If we got something wrong, or if you have a suggestion, criticism of our history, drop us a line at dmofnone@gmail.com. Rob, before I turn it over to you to say the thing, next time on the history of reaction in D&D, diversity comes to our beloved Dungeons & Dragons.
That's right. Diversity.
And D&D.
Stay tuned, everybody. It's going to be a good one. Stay healthy, stay safe, and keep rolling them dice.